Second step, science and technology as an evolutionary process. Campbell, 1974, took another step towards the application of Darwinian theory to science, although we can consider science as a subset of culture, hence every aspect is relevant by definition, by comparing new ideas to mutations in genes, as a prerequisite for a mutant gene to be able to survive, it must first meet the structural selective requirements of being a gene. Likewise, new scientific ideas must meet the implicit requirements of being accepted by the scientific community. Just as genes must adhere to the DNA rules which preserve the ever-developing inheritance, the scientific community has its tribal continuity which must be maintained. There is a difference, however, between illegally mutated ideas and genes. Ideas can still cause a paradigm shift which will make them legal in the new paradigm, whereas illegal genes, as defined above, will not survive. So, in Campbell's view, the survival of scientific ideas depends not only on their actual compliance with some objective truth, but also on their conformity to the tribal basic instinct for survival. An idea is not followed up because it would offend the laboratory head, or because it would give comfort to a rival research group, or because of lack of funding. An idea is rejected because of reasons why it will not work, or because of rumors that a trusted researcher is known to have tried it and failed. Campbell, 1997, 8.12. Similar ideas were expressed by Collins, 1985, who coined the term corset, which basically means the leaders who keep the scientific tribe together. An idea is not followed up because it would offend the laboratory head, or because it would give comfort to a rival research group, or because of lack of funding. An idea is rejected because of reasons why it will not work, or because of rumors that a trusted researcher is known to have tried it and failed. Campbell, 1997, 8.12. This criterion should be regarded as the environment which affects the natural selection of scientific ideas. Moreover, a strategy of maintaining tribal continuity is probably inherited in the scientific community and resides in the genes, or means, of the members. In a way it resembles the selfishness of the genes, as discussed in Dawkins, 1976, where the main driving force for survival in the natural selection is described as the need to preserve the genes' continuity. After establishing the survival strategy, the next step must be to determine the variation mechanism. In natural Darwinism, it consists of random mutation and natural selection preferring the fittest, what is the equivalent in the scientific case. In fact, at first glance one might wonder if there is any resemblance, as science advances by logic, deduction, engineering and mathematical reasoning, how can these fundamental advantages of scientific thought be compared to a random, blind process? Campbell's 1962 major contribution was indeed the insight of the pseudorandom nature of scientific progress. In his paper he describes scientific progress as something which cannot be deduced from prior knowledge. Each step which expanded knowledge beyond anything that could be deduced, was blind and taken in a trial and error process. Thus we may have found the missing element in the analogy between scientific progress and Darwinian theory. A blind variation and selective retention process is fundamental to all inductive achievements, to all genuine increases in knowledge, to all increases in fit of system to environment. Campbell, 1960, 2.1.1. Campbell was probably aware of the hole in his theory, which neglected the intentional nature of scientific progress, but he nevertheless contended that even planned steps, to which he referred as shortcuts, are more blind than deductive. The many processes which shortcut a more full blind variation and selective retention process are in themselves inductive achievements, containing wisdom about the environment achieved originally by blind variation and selective retention. Campbell, 1960, 2.1.3. The many processes which shortcut a more full blind variation and selective retention process are in themselves inductive achievements, containing wisdom about the environment achieved originally by blind variation and selective retention. Campbell, 1960, 2.1.3. A more comprehensive theory of how scientific progress is achieved was presented by Pickering, 1995. He referred to the two sides, scientists, human agency, and science/technology, material agency, as participating in the same actor network, mutually affecting each other. The technological progress is an unstable process until it becomes tuned. As human agencies strive to advance by modifying the material agencies, they encounter resistance, i.e. things are not working exactly as planned, which in turn needs to be accommodated by further modification. This resistance-accommodation relationship was described as a kind of dance which has a direction. This direction is not straightforward and is continuously modified by redefining of the gaps and the new goals. This type of progress was called by Pickering the mingle of practice, with an evolutionary type of unpredictable behavior. Others, Tenner, 1997, Brown and Dugwood, 2000, referred to the same phenomenon as technology's bite back and fight back. Others, Tenner, 1997, Brown and Dugwood, 2000, referred to the same phenomenon as technology's bite back and fight back. Thus, Pickering was able to show that although technological progress appears to have an intentional nature coupled with engineering logic, it is much closer to the trial and error process judged by the force of natural selection, as are other evolutionary blind variation and selective retention phenomena. Scientists do not simply fix their goals once and for all and stick to them, come what may. In the struggles with material agency that I call tuning, plans and goals too are at stake and liable to revision. And thus the intentional character of human agency has a further aspect of temporal emergence, being reconfigured itself in the real time of practice, as well as a further aspect of intertwining with material agency, being reciprocally redefined in the contours of material agency in tuning. Pickering, 1995, 20. Scientists do not simply fix their goals once and for all and stick to them, come what may. In the struggles with material agency that I call tuning, plans and goals too are at stake and liable to revision. And thus the intentional character of human agency has a further aspect of temporal emergence, being reconfigured itself in the real time of practice, as well as a further aspect of intertwining with material agency, being reciprocally redefined in the contours of material agency in tuning. Pickering, 1995, 20. Lastly, as a special case of technological change, we will examine expert systems' fundamental paradigms, and endeavor to identify additional analogies with Darwinian evolution processes, beyond those that are common to every technology.